This feels like home to you, doesn't it? A bit of a homecoming in a way?
Coming to Comic-Con is always a homecoming of sorts, but a kind of very scary homecoming in which 150,000 people want you to sign pieces of paper.
That happens to you all the time, doesn't it?
It's like, well, not like this. This is like being the Beatles for a weekend. Obviously, during the sort of the Hard Day's Night phase of being a Beatle. Not during the, I don't yet have to grow the long beard and go off with the Maharishi.
Okay, cool. So you're running around a lot, you know, Richard Lester style?
Lots of running around.
Yeah.
And lots of just having, just the glorious madness of Comic-Con, in which everything is squeezed, everything is mad. Mm-hmm. You say hello in passing to some guy that you half recognize in the corridor and then realize he was the head of Warner Studios. Yeah, so that kind of thing.
It's cool. And of course, you're here with Caroline. You're very, very proud of
it. I'm incredibly proud of it. It's Henry. I was a fan of Henry's from 1992, 93. Whenever Nightmare came out, mm-hmm. I saw it. And despite the fact the title of the film was Tim Burton's The Nightmare Before Christmas, I actually noticed that it was directed by a man called Henry Selick.
One of the few.
I was one of the few. And then went off and saw James and the Giant Peach, which I enjoyed. Not as much as I'd enjoyed Nightmare, but I really did enjoy... I enjoyed the animated stuff. Mm. And could see that there was a vision going on there, and see that there was somebody who was not scared of darkness.
Absolutely.
And so when I finished Coraline in about 2000, yeah. I sent the manuscript to Henry. And then it just took us 9 years to make a movie.
It does that with his style of filmmaking anyway, doesn't it?
It really does. Even when they started making it, every 3 or 4 months they would send me a DVD with what they had done since the last time on it. and storyboards for the rest of it. And I would sit there and some sequences would have just expanded by what seemed like 2 or 3 seconds, and other times you'd have whole little scenes in.
Oh, fantastic. Neil, do you have your iPhone with you by any chance?
Actually, I don't have my iPhone. I have my MyTouch, the Google phone, the G2, it's not called a G2, the unreleased thing, but I do, yes.
I'd love to do a Twitter interview with you.
Absolutely,
let's tweet.
Twitter interview.
We're doing the world's first Twitter interview, so I'll just ask you a question.
This is a Twitter view,
Twitter view, so there we go, as you can see, at Neil himself. What...
Okay, so.
Send. That's amazing.
I'm going to have to keep refreshing here.
This, we haven't thought this through at all.
We really haven't thought this through. But then again, this is on video. It can be edited.
It can be edited
into something that looks like we know what we're doing. We don't know what we're doing.
I sent you a really, really searching question as well.
Good. Had you already typed it?
I had already typed it. Here we go.
Empire Magazine have tweeted me. Neil himself. What do you think of Coraline?
Tough questions. Probing stuff.
Whoa. I click reply. I shake it so that it will give me an on-screen keyboard that's actually type-onable rather than one. Oops. This is the trouble with... there are things that I hate in this world, and on-screen...
But this is the first. This is a world first.
This is. You are actually getting to see us click the thing, give it a question mark, and go... Hang on. Almost. There we go.
Okay, fantastic.
And I have replied to their interview question. This is live on television. I feel like...
This is live.
Do you remember Tomorrow's World?
I do remember Tomorrow's World.
This is like Tomorrow's World.
Am I Maggie Philbin in this scenario? Oh, here we go. From Neil Gaiman, Empire Magazine. What kind of question is that? Call yourself a reporter. Just what my mum used to say. Thank you, sir.
You're so welcome. Thank you.